Das Schiff trug Kinder. Kinder, mit denen irgendetwas nicht in Ordnung war. Das Schiff war voll beladen. Es fuhr die Westküste entlang und nahm immer noch Kinder auf. Kinder mit langen Mänteln und ganz kleinen Rucksäcken. Kinder, die fliehen mussten. Keines von ihnen hatte die Erlaubnis, zu bleiben. Und keines von ihnen hatte die Erlaubnis, zu gehen. Kinder mit falschen Großeltern, Kinder ohne Pass und ohne Visum, Kinder, für die niemand mehr bürgen konnte. Deshalb fuhren sie bei Nacht. Niemand wusste davon. Sie wichen den Leuchttürmen aus und machten große Bogen um die Ozeandampfer. Wenn sie Fischerbooten begegneten, baten sie um Brot. Um Mitleid baten sie niemanden.
The boat set sail from Hamburg. The boat was carrying children. Children who had something or other wrong with them. The boat was fully laden. It sailed along the west coast, taking on children all the while. Children with long coats and very small knapsacks. Children who had to flee.
Children with the wrong kind of grandparents.
Children with neither passport nor visa.
Children who had no one left to vouch for them.
That's why they traveled at night.
No one knew about it.
I'm asking you!
Ilse Aichinger published Die größere Hoffnung in 1948. The main character in the novel, as we've heard, in effect, is a girl of partly Jewish heritage called Ellen.
The narrative is clearly based on the author's own experiences in Nazi-controlled Vienna between 1938 and 1945, and it emphasises phenomena such as attempts to emigrate, state-organised deportation and murder, and the liberation of the city by a foreign army. My expertise is as a translator rather than as a scholar of Aichinger. So what I'd like to talk about a little is what struck me from the translator's viewpoint as important characteristics of the novel and how I dealt with them. And so you won't find this discussion of translation strategies as abstruse as it might sound. We'll be illustrating what I have to say with readings from the novel itself. Probably the most significant feature of The Greater Hope from the translator's viewpoint is Aichinger's style, which is very diverse, very elusive, and very carefully wrought. By very diverse, I mean that the style combines elements such as quite childlike dialogue between Ellen and her young friends, and the crudely militaristic language of the authorities who persecute them, and stylistically rather elevated passages in which the third-person narrator comments on the significance of Ellen's experiences, and so on. In saying that Aichinger's style is very elusive, I mean that her imagery is complex, drawing on her own personal system of symbols, as well as on aspects of the German-speaking cultural tradition, and on aspects of the Jewish tradition, and on aspects of the Catholic tradition. And by saying that the novel or the novel style is very carefully wrought, I mean that the narrative deploys a number of recurring and symbolically significant keywords, or even complexes of keywords. And it was important to recognise these and to translate them consistently. One very significant complex of words is the verbs relating to the shining of light. Glänzen, strahlen, funkeln, leuchten, and glühen, together with associated nouns like der Glanz. Although all of that's extremely complicated, so I'll be using other examples of keywords today. To give you an idea of some of the stylistic diversity, I'd like to consider an episode which begins in the fifth paragraph of the novel, when the very young Ellen dreams about how she and other children might emigrate from their home country.
Das Schiff ging von Hamburg aus in See.
The boat set sail from Hamburg.
Das Schiff trug Kinder.
The boat was carrying children.
Kinder, mit denen irgendetwas nicht in Ordnung war.
Children who had something or other wrong with them.
Das Boot war voll beladen.
The boat was fully laden.
Es fuhr die Westküste entlang und nahm immer noch Kinder auf.
It sailed along the west coast, taking on children all the time.
Kinder mit langen Mänteln und ganz kleinen Rucksäcken.
Children with long coats and very small knapsacks.
Kinder, die fliehen mussten.
Children who had to flee.
Keines von ihnen hatte die Erlaubnis zu bleiben.
Not one of them had permission to stay.
Und keines von ihnen hatte die Erlaubnis zu gehen.
And not one of them had permission to go.
Kinder mit falschen Großeltern, Kinder ohne Pass und ohne Visum, Kinder, für die niemand mehr bürgen konnte.
Children with wrong kind of grandparents, children with neither a passport nor a visa, children who had no one left to vouch for them.
Deshalb fuhren sie bei Nacht.
That's why they travelled at night.
Niemand wusste davon.
Nobody knew about it.
Sie wichen den Leuchttürmen aus und machten große Bogen um die Ozeandampfer.
They avoided the lighthouses and made great detours around ocean-going liners.
Wenn sie Fischerbooten begegneten, baten sie um Brot.
When they encountered fishing boats, they asked for bread.
Um Mitleid baten sie niemanden.
They didn't ask anyone for sympathy.
In der Mitte des Ozeans streckten sie die Köpfe über den Schiffsrand und begannen zu singen. Summ, 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 Bienchen summ herum. It's a long way to Tipperary. Häschen in der Grube und noch vieles andere.
In the middle of the ocean, they stretched their heads over the side of the boat and began to sing the song about the busy, buzzy bumblebee. It's a long way to Tipperary. The one about the bunny in his burrow and lots more.
Der Mond legte eine silberne Christbaumkette über das Meer. Wusste, dass sie keinen Steuermann hatten.
The moon laid a strand of silver Christmas tinsel across the sea. He knew they had no one to vouch for them.
Der Wind fuhr hilfreich in ihre Segel.
Yeah, the wind blew helpfully into their sails.
Fühlte mit ihnen. War auch einer von denen, für die niemand bürgen konnte.
He felt what they were feeling. He too was one of those who had no one to vouch for them.
Ein Haifisch schwamm neben ihnen her.
A shark swam along beside them.
Er hatte sich das Recht ausgebeten, sie von den Menschen beschützen zu dürfen.
Yeah, when he had asked, they had granted him the right to be allowed to protect them from people.
Wenn er Hunger bekam, gaben sie ihm von ihrem Brot. Und er bekam ziemlich oft Hunger.
When he felt hungry, they gave him some of their bread. And he felt hungry quite often.
Auch für ihn konnte niemand bürgen. Yeah.
He had no one to vouch for him either.
Er erzählte den Kindern, dass Jagd nach ihm gemacht wurde. Und die Kinder erzählten ihm, dass Jagd nach ihnen gemacht wurde, dass sie heimlich fuhren und dass es sehr aufregend war.
He told the children he was being hunted. And the children told him that they were being hunted and that they were traveling secretly and that it was very exciting.
Sie hatten keinen Pass und kein Visum.
They had neither a passport nor a visa.
Aber sie wollten um jeden Preis hinüberkommen.
But they wanted to get to the other side at any price.
Der Haifisch tröstete sie, wie nur ein Haifisch trösten kann. Und er blieb neben ihnen.
The shark comforted them as only a shark can, and he stayed along beside them.
Als der Haifisch den Kindern gerade einen Witz erzählen wollte, um sie von ihren traurigen Gedanken abzulenken, brach ein furchtbarer Sturm los. Der arme Haifisch wurde von einer riesigen Woge weit hinausgeschleudert.
As the shark was just about to tell the children a joke to distract them from their sad thoughts, a terrible storm broke out. The poor shark was swept a long way off by a huge wave.
Entsetzt riss der Mond die Christbaumkette zurück.
Horrified, the moon snatched back the Christmas tinsel.
Kohlschwarzes Wasser spritzte über das kleine Boot.
Coal black water splashed across the little boat.
Die Kinder schrien laut um Hilfe.
The children cried out loudly for help.
Niemand hatte für sie gebürgt.
No one had vouched for them.
Keines von ihnen hatte einen Rettungsgürtel.
Not one of them had a life belt.
Groß und licht und unerreichbar tauchte die Freiheitsstatue aus dem Schrecken.
Tall and bright and unreachable, the statue of liberty arose from amid the fear.
Zum ersten und zum letzten Male.
For the first and for the last time.
There are a lot of things I could talk about here, but I'd like to concentrate on how the style mostly reflects the innocence and simplicity of childhood. For example, in the references to the two German children's songs, where I tried to retain the onomatopoeia and the diminutives by translating zum, 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 bienchen, zum herum as the song about the busy, buzzy bumblebee, and Häschen in der Grube as the one about the bunny in his burrow. But the simple childlike language also has ominous overtones, most obviously in the way that Nazi racialist policies are evoked in the children's references to their grandparents. And I thought that it was best to keep the translation fairly simple by rendering Kinder mit falschen Großeltern as children with the wrong kind of grandparents, particularly as Ellen and her friends use this phrase when talking amongst themselves later in the novel. And although I've been talking about simple and childlike language, when you heard the German text, you probably noticed the intrusion of the more bureaucratic and, as it were, more grown-up Bürgenführer. In the context of emigre children who are sailing towards the Statue of Liberty, this evokes the historical phenomenon of US residents who were required to swear affidavits saying that they were prepared to take financial responsibility for refugees. dealing with this verb was quite difficult, because later in the novel, it's used to express a broader idea of humans' moral responsibilities towards each other. So after initially intending to translate it as to offer security for, eventually I settled on to vouch for. I'll turn now to the end of the first chapter, when Ellen is beginning to accept that she might never be able to leave her home country, and finds herself drawn to a church.
Dunklen Blickes, das Kreuz in der erhobenen, hageren Hand, stehend auf einem glühenden Gipfel, wartete Franz Xaver.
His face clouded, the cross raised in his lean hand, standing on a burning peak, Franz Xaver waited.
Ich weiß nicht, weshalb ich gerade zu dir komme.
I don't know why I've come to you in particular.
Sie hatte diejenigen niemals verstanden, denen es Vergnügen machte, in die Kirche zu gehen und die schwelgend davon sprachen, wie von einem Genuss.
She had never understood those people who enjoyed going to church and who talked about it extravagantly as if it was a physical pleasure.
Nein, es war kein Genuss.
No, it wasn't a pleasure.
Eher war es ein Leiden, das Leiden nach sich zog.
It was more like a sorrow that led to more sorrow.
Und beten?
And praying?
Ellen hätte es lieber gelassen.
Ellen would rather have done without it.
Vor einem Jahr hatte sie Kopfspringen gelernt und es ging ähnlich.
A year ago she'd learned to dive. And that was much the same.
Man musste auf ein hohes Sprungbrett steigen, um tief hinunterzukommen.
You had to climb onto a high diving board to get down to the depths.
Und dann war es immer noch ein Entschluss, zu springen, es hinzunehmen, dass Franz Xaver nicht hersah und sich zu vergessen.
Then you still had to decide to make the leap, to accept that Franz Xaver wasn't looking at you and to forget about yourself.
Angestrengt versuchte sie, ihm alles zu erklären.
She tried with all her might to explain everything to him.
Meine Mutter ist drüben, aber sie kann nicht für mich bürgen. Niemand bürgt für mich. Könntest nicht du? Ich meine, könntest nicht du jemandem eingeben, dass er für mich bürgt? Ich würde dich auch nicht enttäuschen, wenn ich erst einmal in der Freiheit bin.
My mother is over there, but she can't vouch for me. No one is vouching for me. Couldn't you? I mean, couldn't you inspire someone to vouch for me? And I wouldn't disappoint you either. If I could just reach freedom.
Der Heilige schien verwundert.
The saint seemed surprised.
Ellen merkte, dass sie nicht genau gesagt hatte, was sie meinte.
Ellen realized she hadn't said exactly what she meant.
Mit Mühe schob sie beiseite, was sie von sich selbst trennte.
With an effort, she pushed aside what was dividing her from herself.
Das heißt, ich würde dich keinesfalls enttäuschen, auch wenn ich hier bleiben, auch wenn ich in Tränen ertrinken müsste.
What I'm saying is, I would never disappoint you. Even if I had to stay here. Even if I had to drown in tears.
Wieder schien der Heilige verwundert, und sie musste noch weitergehen.
Again the saint seemed surprised and she had to go further.
Das heißt, ich würde nicht in Tränen ertrinken. Ich würde immer versuchen, dir keinen Vorwurf zu machen. Auch dann, wenn ich nicht frei würde.
What I'm saying is, I wouldn't drown in tears. I'd always try not to blame you. Even if I didn't find freedom.
Noch ein einziges stummes Verwundern Franz Xavers und die letzte Tür wich zurück.
Still nothing but wordless surprise on Franz Xaver's part. And the last door began to open.
Das heißt, ich meinte, ich weiß nicht, was notwendig ist, damit ich frei werde. Ich bitte dich, was auch immer geschieht, hilf mir daran zu glauben, dass irgendwo alles blau wird. Hilf mir, über das Wasser zu gehen, auch wenn ich hier bleiben muss.
What I'm saying is, I meant, I don't know what has to be done for me to find freedom. I'm asking you, whatever happens, help me to believe that somewhere there's a place where everything turns blue. Help me to cross the ocean, even if I have to stay here.
Das Gespräch mit dem Heiligen war zu Ende.
The conversation with the saint had reached its end.
Alle Türen standen offen.
All doors stood open.
Although this passage includes some quite complex and poetic language, to which I hope I did justice in the translation you've heard, the dominant feature here once again is the simplicity of the style. But now the simple language has a more overt symbolic significance, because the characterization of the place of safety and somehow also of transcendence, which Ellen may never reach, as the place where everything is blau, recurs through the remainder of the novel. And at the end of this passage, there's also the image of the Tür, which opens as Ellen gains a more profound understanding of her situation. I'll admit that I'm not entirely sure of the full symbolic significance of either of these ideas, although I could make a few suggestions. But the good news from the translator's viewpoint was that there was really only one straightforward way of translating each. Blau as blue and Tür as door. Even so, this passage turned out to be more complex than I'd originally assumed. Because it was only when I'd gone over everything a number of times and thought that I was just proofreading my final translation that I realised that Ellen's childlike musings here about learning to dive off the high board actually resonate with the final paragraphs of the novel. Before talking about those final paragraphs, I'd like to look at the closing scenes of the chapter in which Ellen's grandmother, who is about to be removed from her home by the authorities and presumably killed, reasserts control of her own destiny by committing suicide.
The grandmother sighed inaudibly and closed her eyes.
Großmutter, spuck es aus! Stirb nicht, Großmutter! Stirb nicht!
Grandmother, spit it out! Don't die, Grandmother.
Die Großmutter wollte noch etwas. Sie verlangte, und ihr Verlangen schien unersättlich. Ihre Hände befreiten sich aus der Umklammerung und begannen wiederum ruhelos über die Decke zu tanzen.
There was something the grandmother still wanted. She was demanding something and seemed insatiable. Her hands freed themselves from Ellen's grip and began to dance restlessly over the blanket again.
Was suchst du?
What are you searching for?
Weißt du, was du suchst,
Do you know what it is you're searching for, Grandmother?
Einmal war es dein Taschentuch.
One time, it was your handkerchief.
Ein anderes Mal wieder dein Opernglas.
And another time, it was your opera glasses.
Und zuletzt das Gift.
And finally, it was the poison.
Was suchst du? Sag mir, was du suchst.
What are you searching for? Tell me, what you're searching for.
Willst du leben?
Do you want to live?
Ellen sprang auf den Fußboden und holte ihr schwarzes, dickes Gebetbuch aus dem alten Schrank. Auf der letzten Seite standen die Sterbegebete.
Ellen jumped onto the floor and took her black, thick prayer book from the old wardrobe. The prayers for the dying were on the last page.
An den Flüssen Babels saßen sie und weinten, sagte die Nacht unvermittelt.
By the rivers of Babylon, there they sat down. Yea, they wept, the night said suddenly.
Das hörte Ellen, und sie sah sie an den Flüssen sitzen, und sie sah, wie die Flüsse immer größer wurden von ihren Tränen.
Ellen heard that, and she saw them sitting by the rivers, and she saw how the rivers grew even larger from their tears.
Aber sie sprangen nicht hinein.
But they didn't jump in.
Sie warteten immer noch und sangen fremde, traurige Lieder und sprachen singend weiter.
They were waiting. They were still waiting and singing strange, sad songs and still speaking in a sing-song.
Vier von ihnen standen auf und kamen auf das alte Bett zu.
Four of them stood up and moved towards the old bed.
Gleich würden sie die Großmutter packen und sie würden sie hinaustragen auf den letzten Friedhof, der furchtsam im grauenden Morgen schlief.
In a moment they would grab the grandmother and they would carry her out to the last cemetery, which was sleeping fearfully in the graying light of morning.
Und sie würden beten, singen und weinen, aber ihre Gebete blieben wie leere Schläuche am Boden liegen, stumm und traurig.
And they would pray, sing and weep, but their prayers remained lying on the ground like empty tubes, silent and sad.
Der Wein ist abgeleitet.
The wine has been drained from those wine skins.
Dieser Friedhof hatte die älteste Geheimnummer, aber seine Wächter hatten sie vergessen. Und alle, die dort lagen, litten darunter.
The cemetery had the oldest secret number, but its watchman had forgotten the number, and everyone who lay there suffered because of that.
Sie hatten ebenso wie Ellens sterbende Großmutter ihr ganzes Leben nach allen möglichen Dingen verlangt, die sie gar nicht wollten. Sie hatten alle möglichen Nummern angerufen. Aber im Grund waren sie immer falsch verbunden gewesen, denn keine war die Geheimnummer.
Just like Ellen's dying grandmother, all their lives they had demanded all kinds of things which they didn't want at all. They had rung up all kinds of numbers, but in essence, they had been talking to the wrong numbers, for none of them was the secret number.
Wartet! Vielleicht weiß ich sie! Vielleicht weiß ich sie für euch! Wollt ihr leben?
Wait, all of you. Maybe I know the number. Maybe I can give it to you. Do you want to live?
Die Nase der Großmutter trat spitz hervor. Ihre Wangen fielen ein.
The grandmother's nose became sharper and more prominent. Her cheeks collapsed.
Der Meister selbst tat die letzten Griffe. Und verwischte das Verwischende.
The hands of the master himself made the final gestures, extinguishing what was extinguishing itself.
Ellen riss die Augen auf. Sie bewegte formend die Hände, als könnte sie der Dämmerung das Wort entreißen, das die Großmutter erweckte.
Ellen opened her eyes wide. She made shapes with her hands as if she could tear the word which would wake up the grandmother away from the twilight.
Zum Sprung geduckt lag sie am Fußende des Bettes und verharrte in Stille, in dem Schweigen der Bereitschaft.
Ellen opened her eyes wide and crouched to spring. She lay at the foot of the bed and waited without speaking. In the silence of readiness.
Das Hemd der Großmutter war zerrissen, die Decke abgeworfen.
The grandmother's nightgown was in shreds, the blanket cast off.
Großmutter, was suchst du? Großmutter, willst du leben?
Grandmother, what are you searching for? Grandmother, do you want to live?
Durch eine kleine Bewegung lockerte sich der Draht der Bettlampe.
With a small movement, the cord on the bed lamp loosened.
Das Licht ging aus.
The light went out.
Noch einmal zuckte der Kopf der Sterbenden vor der nahen Finsternis zurück. Der Körper bäumte sich auf.
Once more the dying woman's head jerked back in the face of the imminent darkness. The body reared.
Ellen sprang. Sie packte das halbleere Glas.
Ellen sprang. She grabbed the half-empty glass.
Drei Schluck fehlten.
Three swallows had been taken.
Und sie goss den Rest des Wassers über die weiße, eckige Stirn, über Hals und Brust in die steifen Kissen.
And she poured the remainder of the water over the white, square forehead, over the neck and the chest, into the stiff pillows.
Sie sagte mitten in das letzte einsame Röcheln.
Into the middle of the last lonely death rattle, she said.
Großmutter, ich taufe dich im Namen des Vaters und des Sohnes und des Heiligen Geistes. Amen.
Grandmother, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Die Nacht sank dem Tag in die Arme.
The night sank into the arms of the day.
Really, I want to let the power of Aichinger's writing in this passage speak for itself. So I'll just make a few remarks about how, as the translator, I tried to maintain the closely wrought links between what's happening here and what's happening elsewhere in the novel. And in particular, what's happening in the chapter in which Ellen and her friends write and perform a kind of nativity play, just among themselves. A key word in that chapter is the verb suchen, which expresses how the characters in the play are seeking peace and solace and some kind of enlightenment, just as the children seeking solace in writing and performing the play. You'll have noticed that suchen is also a key word in the minutes before the grandmother's death. So I was careful to maintain that link by translating it in both chapters as search. Another key word in the nativity play is zerrissen, as applied to the clothing of those who are searching for peace and solace. And it recurs here in the final reference to the grandmother's nightgown. So again, I was careful to maintain the link by using the idea of shreds both times. In fact, the idea that the world and the world of the novel is zerrissen is initiated in the very first paragraph of the narrative, which refers to the Zerrissenheit of coastlines on a map, which I had to think about for a long time and eventually translated as shredded looking coastlines. The last chapter of The Greater Hope takes place during the final battle for the city where Ellen lives. And it links the idea of Ellen crossing a bridge to take a letter to a soldier with the idea of Ellen going home, in both a literal and a metaphorical sense. As she moves towards the bridge, her mind goes back over several important incidents in the story. And she sees the face of her young friend Georg, who was killed some time before.
Sie begann wieder zu laufen.
She began running again.
Wie Fenster am heiligen Abend hob sich das Rot aus dem Grau.
Like windows on Christmas Eve, the red emerged out of the grey.
Kalt war der Morgen.
Oh, the morning was very cold.
Unberührt tauchten in der Ferne die Berge über das Getümmel.
Far away the mountains rose untouched above the chaos.
Diese Berge, hinter denen es blau wurde.
Behind these mountains, it was turning blue.
Was auch geschieht, dachte Ellen.
Whatever happens, Ellen thought.
Sie hielt sich dicht an die Mauer.
She kept close to the wall.
Wie oft war sie so gelaufen?
How many times had she run like this?
Und hatte nicht immer jemand weit hinter ihr gerufen?
And hadn't someone way behind her always called out?
Bleib stehen! Lauf nicht so schnell, sonst fällst du! Warte, bis ich dich einhole!
Stop! Don't run so fast or you'll fall! Wait till I catch up with you!
Jetzt rief es weit vor ihr.
Now a call was coming from way in front of her.
Lauf schneller, lauf noch schneller. Bleib nicht mehr stehen, sonst fällst du. Denk nicht mehr nach, sonst vergisst du. Warte, bis du dich einholst.
Run faster, run even faster. Don't stop or you'll fall. Don't think anymore or you'll forget. Wait till you catch up with yourself.
Irgendwann musste man springen.
You had to make the leap eventually.
Ellen wusste, dass sie keine Zeit mehr hatte.
Ellen knew that she had run out of time.
Sie wusste, dass sie bald springen würde.
She knew that she would jump soon.
Es war alles ein einziger Anlauf gewesen.
It had all been one big run-up.
Vater und Mutter.
Father and mother.
Der Konsul und Franz Xaver.
The Consul and Franz Xaver.
Der Kai und die englische Stunde.
The key and the English lessons.
Die Großmutter.
The grandmother.
Der Oberst und die Einbrecher in dem verschütteten Keller.
The colonel and the men who broke into the bombed-in cellar.
Das tote Pferd.
The dead horse.
Das Feuer am Teich und diese letzte Nacht.
The fire beside the pond. And this last night.
Ellen jauchzte leise.
Ellen rejoiced softly.
Noch einmal hätte sie es allen ins Gesicht schreien wollen.
She would have liked to shout it into all their faces one more time.
Es ist ein Anlauf. Irgendwo wird es blau. Vergesst nicht zu springen.
It's a run-up. Somewhere, it's turning blue. Don't forget to jump!
Wie ein Schild hielt sie den Brief.
She held the letter like a sign.
Es war ihr, als flöge sie zum letzten Mal auf dem alten Ringelspiel.
She felt like she was flying on the old merry-go-round for the last time.
Die eisernen Ketten krachten.
The iron chains made cracking sounds.
Sie waren bereit, Ellen fliegen zu lassen.
They were ready to break.
Sie waren bereit, zu zerreißen.
They were ready to let Ellen fly away.
Ellen lief gegen den Kai.
Ellen ran towards the quay.
Gegen die umkämpften Brücken.
Towards the bridges where the battle was continuing.
Sie lief dem König Frieden auf seinem Kreuzweg nach.
She ran after the King of Peace on his way to the cross.
Niemand hielt sie mehr auf.
No one tried to stop her anymore.
Niemand konnte sie aufhalten.
No one could stop her.
Ein Posten nahm ihr den Brief ab.
A sentry took the letter from her.
Eine Frau im hellen Mantel schrie.
A woman in a light-colored coat shouted.
Nicht dorthin! Ihr Mantel war mit Blut bespritzt.
Don't go there! Her coat was splattered with blood.
Sie griff nach Ellens Hand, aber Ellen riss sich los, geriet in eine Wolke von beißendem Dampf und rieb sich die Augen.
She reached for Ellen's hand, but Ellen tore herself away and found herself in a cloud of acrid smoke and rubbed her eyes.
Blinzelnd.
Blinking.
Nahm sie eine Menge hin- und herlaufender Gestalten wahr.
She could make out numbers of figures running here and there.
Balken und Geschütze.
Girders and heavy guns.
Und das grau-grüne, aufgewühlte Wasser.
And the grey-green churning water.
Hier war die Unordnung nicht mehr zu lösen.
Here there was no more chance of sorting out the confusion.
Aber dahinter wurde es blau.
But beyond here, it was turning blue.
Noch einmal hörte Ellen das grelle, erschrockene Schreien der fremden Soldaten.
Once again, Ellen heard the shrill, shocked shouting of the foreign soldiers.
Sie sah Georgs Gesicht über sich heller und durchsichtiger, als es jemals gewesen war.
She saw Georg's face above her, brighter and more transparent than it had ever been.
Georg! Die Brücke steht nicht mehr.
Georg, the bridge has collapsed.
Wir bauen sie neu.
We'll rebuild it.
Wie soll sie heißen?
What shall we call it?
Die größere Hoffnung. Unsere Hoffnung.
The greater hope. Our hope.
Georg. Georg, ich sehe den Stern.
Georg. Georg. I can see the star.
Die brennenden Augen auf den zersplitterten Rest der Brücke gerichtet.
With burning eyes faced on the splintered remains of the bridge.
Sprang Ellen über eine aus dem Boden gerissene, emporklaffende Straßenbahnschiene.
Ellen jumped over a piece of destroyed tram line which was jutting up from the ground.
Und wurde, noch ehe die Schwerkraft sie wieder zur Erde zog,
and before gravity could pull her to the earth again,
von einer explodierenden Granate in Stücke gerissen.
She was torn to pieces by an exploding shell.
Über den umkämpften Brücken stand der Morgenstern.
The battle for the bridges continued. Above them stood the morning star.
Here again, I'd really like to let the literary quality of the novel speak for itself. So I'll just note a couple of things. Firstly, there's the recurrence of the blau-blue imagery. And secondly, there's the development of the earlier motif from the scene in the church with Franz Xaver, the painting of Franz Xaver, about learning to dive off the high board. In that scene, Ellen felt that es war immer noch ein Entschluss zu springen. And now, she feels that all of her experiences to this point have been a run-up, a preparation for crossing the bridge and going home. So that irgendwann musste man springen. So the jump from the high board has become a leap of faith. And I translated springen as leap both times to maintain that connection. In closing, I'd like to say something about a sentence in what you just heard, which probably particularly caught your attention. Namely, Ellen's feeling, or the narrative's feeling, that as she ran after the King of Peace on his way to the cross. In the German text, the biblical reference to the way of the cross is complemented by a secondary meaning of Kreuzweg, as a crossing point or a moment or place of decision, which appears at some significant places earlier in the novel. And I'm mentioning this as an example of my inadequacy as a translator, because I simply couldn't think of any way of incorporating that secondary meaning. And I'm concluding my remarks by noting my inadequacy as a translator, because although I think that literary translation is important, I also think that the authors of literary texts, which people like me translate, are more important for obvious reasons. So when I ask you to join me now in thanking my colleagues who have read from Die größere Hoffnung and from The Greater Hope for us, I'd ask you also to honour Ilse Aichinger, who on the 1st of November this year will turn 95.
Dr. Wilkes, congratulations on your translation of Aichinger's seminal novel, Die größere Hoffnung. The English-speaking world now has The Greater Hope. Now, what were the challenges you faced in this translation?
Well, I did make some notes about that and various points, in fact, so that I could explain them properly. I said that the narrative is clearly based on Ilse Aichinger's own experiences in Nazi-controlled Vienna between 1938 and 1945. But one quite tricky element from the translator's viewpoint is how that time and that place are almost never made entirely explicit in the narrative. As far as the city is concerned, there are various references such as Die Insel and Die Nordbahn, which can be associated with Vienna. But on the face of them, they're not necessarily exclusive to Vienna.
No.
So I thought it was best to translate them rather generically as the island and the Northern Railway and so on. As far as the Nazi control from 1938 to 1945 is concerned, it seemed to me that Aichinger is suggesting that the specific experiences then have a broader and more transcendent significance for the world that came after. Mm-hmm. And that she's doing this by deliberately avoiding specificity most of the time.
Yeah, fair enough. Could you illustrate this?
Yeah, the frequent references to Die Geheime Polizei are part of this. They evoke the Nazis' Geheime Staatspolizei, mm-hmm. but they don't limit themselves to that evocation. So I was careful always to translate Die Geheime Polizei generically as the secret police,
yes.
and never to translate it only as the Gestapo.
Fair enough, yeah.
But there was also a handful of words which did specifically invoke the Nazi era. Ahnenpass, Scharführer, Kindertransport, and of course the word Jude embroidered on the yellow cloth stars. I thought about those words for a long time because at least the first two or three of them wouldn't be familiar to most English language readers. And they're such historically specific terms that I couldn't think of any way to translate or explain them within the narrative itself, as opposed to using a footnote, which I always try to avoid in translating a literary text. And then finally, it occurred to me that those words were historically specific to the German language readers as well. I mean, Ahnenpass can really only mean a specific piece of Nazi cultural racialist bureaucracy. So I decided to leave those German words untranslated in italics in the English text.
Right.
And of course, that makes them rather conspicuous. But I think that they're rather conspicuous in the original German text and that Aichinger wants them to be.
And how then does the dimension of the historical and cultural background impact on your work?
Well, obviously, what I've just been talking about is an example of that, but the historical and cultural background have many more facets than that. So if you take the world of the children, I had to deal not only with the songs I mentioned, but also with references to games like Völkerball and Lotto and Stille Post and a particularly difficult one, Der Kaiser schickt Soldaten aus. And the children's nativity play is symbolically very significant, but also it's written in a rather childish kind of doggerel. So I had to go over that several times trying to highlight the important words while still maintaining the occasionally rather awkward rhyme and rhythm. I mean, I didn't want it to sound like T.S. Eliot.
No. No.
And there are lots of references, of course, to the adult culture and the sort of higher, in scare quotes, culture as well, particularly in songs and hymns.
And could you enlarge on this? Give us some examples.
Yeah, well, sometimes I didn't know the songs. Things like Das Lied von den Blauen Dragonern, which is important in chapter 4. So I had to find out about them, and again, I had to think about rhyme and rhythm.
It's very important, that song, isn't it?
It is, yeah, and that was something that was completely unfamiliar to me, so I had to work a little bit hard on that. But sometimes it was a lot easier, the musical reference was more familiar. For example, during the funeral in chapter 3, when there's a one-line paragraph in the narrative which just says, Herr, bleib bei uns, denn es will Abend werden. And of course, it took me a second or two, but the suitable English equivalent to that is obviously, Lord, abide with us, fast falls the eventide.
Yes.
Beyond that, though, not just to talk about the sort of cultural background, I think the main thing I learned about Die größere Hoffnung and the thing I didn't fully understand about the novel until I came to translate it was how important the repeated words and repeated complex of words are. So I can't really stop talking about that.
Well, no, it's important because she has certain motifs and symbols which are constantly repeated, aren't they, in the novel. In fact, that's why the novel's been described as being multifaceted, multi-layered and terribly complicated and very difficult to understand.
Well, it's a multi-semantic, as it were, within a single word. And probably the best example, the most constantly repeated one, on the face of it, a fairly straightforward word, is the word fremd, which, as I understood it on various occasions throughout the narrative, emphasises the strangeness and the foreignness and the unfamiliarity of Ellen's experiences and the other children's experiences. And I was careful to think that I would say to you strangeness and foreignness and unfamiliarity, that I would say those quite deliberately, because fremd can express all of those things and does express all of those qualities within the novel, so that it wasn't possible to translate fremd with just one word. I had to use three. So to give you a few examples, der Fremde, you remember whom the children encounter during the coach journey when they try to flee the country. He's the stranger. The Fremde Macht, which is invoked in the title of chapter 4, that's the song with the Lied von den Blauen Dragonen, of course, is a foreign power. And the twilight which sits on Ellen's shoulders and urges her on wie ein fremder Reiter when she's running away from one of her pursuers is like an unfamiliar rider. And of course, I was a little bit frustrated that I couldn't get that one word across in one way all the time. But that's how it is with translation sometimes.
Yes, well, can I just say congratulations and thank you for those comments. What would you say was the most difficult aspect then, to finalise, you know, finally sum up, most difficult aspect of this translation, because you have translated a work that's been around now for 70 years, right? A long, long time. So you tackle it. And it's magnificently translated. So what's the core of this? What's the most difficult problem, do you reckon?
Two things, they're probably related. I go back to the fact of how closely wrought it is. It's just as a sort of literary artifact. It's very complex. And to make a proper translation, I think you have to do as much justice as you can to that complexity. Related, but perhaps in a rather paradoxical way, is the elusiveness of the ultimate meaning of what's going on. And that meant that on a lot of occasions, and as I said earlier, I wasn't always entirely sure about the symbolic significance of some things. So I thought it was important to translate them in a way which sort of made space for meaning, which left multiplicities of meanings open.
Yeah.
And they were the two things I think that I was conscious of most of the time, and had most of the time as compared to any other aspect, and that I thought about the most and had the most difficulty with.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you very, very
much. Thank you.